The Diplomats is one of the first student-led clubs of Fulbright University Vietnam. An endless passion for connection is what initially encouraged us to form the Diplomats Club to engage people within Fulbright's community. From a very simple goal of uniting Fulbrighters, we kept on learning, searching, and practicing the art of human interaction. Such intellectual curiosity and commitment inspired the Diplomats to embrace a new vision, to become an academic playground that supports students' journeys on becoming citizen diplomats. For this inaugural year, our ambition is to conduct a documentary that captures the people of diplomacy and the profession itself, for we believe to build connection is to build the world. With this film, we humbly and genuinely wish to share not fantasy, but the essence, the beautiful rawness, the fearless work behind the scenes of those who devote their life to diplomacy. We wholeheartedly welcome you to the world of diplomats. Let us introduce you to our club members. For the making of this film, within the best of our capability, we conducted a series of interviews with individuals, both native and foreign, from diplomats, professionals in international relations, to students and representatives of those who are simply passionate about diplomacy. Moving north to Hanoi, we had a chance to hold a conversation with Tô Khánh Linh, students of Diplomatic Academy of Vietnam, major in International Relations. Going beyond borders, our film features international friends, namely a friend of ours, Nghi Sorong Phuong from Phnom Penh, currently a junior at the Institute of Foreign Languages of the Royal University of Phnom Penh. He had our fair share of diplomatic moments at USD Model Asian Meeting 2019 in Philippines. On the same occasion, we met Kristen Joshua Ramitere. He's a student of Bachelor of Arts in Asian Studies in the Royal and Pontifical Catholic University of the Philippines, the University of Santo Tomas. Besides students, we heard some thought-provoking comments from our professor and club advisor, Dr. Andrew Harold Belisari.
I'm Andrew Belisari, founding faculty member at Fulbright University Vietnam.
We also appreciated the chance to know and talk with Mr. Matthew Ferens, a public affairs official of the U.S. Consulate General in Ho Chi Minh City.
My name's Matt. I'm the public affairs officer at the U.S. Consulate General in Ho Chi Minh City. I've been here for about 6 months. I'll stay for a total of 3 years. I've been a diplomat for a little over 14 years now.
Last but not least, we were honored to have an insightful interview with the admirable Madame Tôn Nữ Thị Ninh, a diplomat, deputy of the People's Council, a cultural, social, and educational activist with over 20 years of experience in diplomacy. Bearing many important titles, president of Ho Chi Minh City Peace and Development Foundation, former ambassador of Vietnam to the EU, Belgium, and Luxembourg, former vice chair, Foreign Affairs Committee, Vietnam National Assembly. The first question we'll look at on our journey of exploring the diplomatic world is very simple, yet sophisticated. What is diplomacy? Madame Ninh, with her years in politics, has offered her own interpretation.
Ngoại giao là định hướng và triển khai cái chính sách đối ngoại và quan hệ quốc tế của một nước. Và ngày nay là của một chủ thể nói chung, chứ không phải chỉ là một nước. Cho nên hiểu ngoại giao hẹp là của một nhà nước, một chính phủ, nhưng mà hiểu rộng ra là của bất cứ một cái thực thể.
For Matthew Ferens, he defined and based diplomacy chiefly on the means of connection.
It's about building relationships and whether these are like, you know, retail level relationships, one-on-one relationships, one-on-two relationships, or wholesale relationships of like building a relationship with the people of Vietnam, right? We call those people-to-people ties. It's about relationships. Mm-hmm. So diplomats work in their interests, right? What those interests are and who those interests are for depends on who the diplomat works for. So if you're a private sector diplomat, if you're working in government relations for ExxonMobil or for Facebook, right? You are going to be doing work in Facebook's interest or ExxonMobil's interest. If you're a U.S. diplomat, you're going to work for the U.S. national interest. If you're a Vietnamese diplomat, you're going to work for the Vietnamese national interest. But you're building relationships to help you advance those national interests and to help you advance those goals. I'm really lucky that, you know, the things the United States wants to do in Vietnam, right, our national interests in Vietnam, are also aligned with the national interests of Vietnam.
Mm.
So it makes it really easy. There's lots of avenues that we can cooperate on. It's good to understand that in the modern world, international relations and diplomacy is not necessarily government to government, right? It's it's people to people, it's company to company, private sector actor. You know, you can work in the private sector and work on diplomacy, right? You can work in the field of international relations if you work for an NGO or a nonprofit.
Matthew described his experience in the field of diplomacy with three keywords:
fun, challenging, and worthwhile.
From the student's perspective, Yong had this idea on how he personally views the profession.
Some people think about hard power. They use like military power, hard power to achieve their goal. But like, I think like diplomacy is not being soft, being like a weak in front of all. Diplomacy is somehow like compromise to, in order to go into the common goal.
Sorong's comment elaborated on that point.
The interaction between one actor and other actors is so-called diplomacy. In other words, diplomacy means the art of interaction or collaboration, which is done to pursue specific interests.
If we define diplomacy in such senses, then who are the diplomats?
Như vậy là người nhà ngoại giao là ai thì nó tương chuyên nghiệp nhất cho đến là là thanh niên bạn coffee to go hay là bạn được biết thì theo một nghĩa nào đó nếu đặt trong một cái tình huống nào đó thì cũng trở thành một người góp phần nhỏ nhỏ vào cái tổng thể hình ảnh đối ngoại hoặc là mặt trận đối ngoại nói chung.
Meanwhile, as an officer of the U.S. consulate, Matthew answered this question by mentioning the diversity of American diplomats.
There's been this realization that like America's diplomats haven't always looked like the rest of America, right? And they haven't always represented the U.S., the sort of broad swath of diversity across the United States. So, you know, that's racial diversity, it's gender diversity, and it's geographical diversity, diversity of experience. For years, the vast majority of American diplomats were white men who'd studied in Ivy League schools. There was a long period of time when to be a woman in the Foreign Service, you could do that, but when you got married or pregnant, you had to quit, right? So that changed, but that's terrible. Now I'm lucky the Consul General here is a woman. The ambassador's deputy is a woman. Like, you know, welcoming women into the workforce has allowed us to really expand, like, the talent that we have working for us. Some of the ambassadors all over the world are women. Our last ambassador to the United Nations was a woman. That's a great thing.
With some primary understanding of what diplomacy is and who are the diplomats, we then asked ourselves, what do they do? More specific, what are the responsibilities and scope of work for a diplomat? Ninh shared her close observation on the work that the professors in her institution, who are also the diplomats, have to cover. Thầy cô ở trường thường đi làm việc ngoại giao với đại sứ các nước khác. Công việc ngoại giao không chỉ là ngồi bàn đàm phán trực tiếp mà còn bao gồm rất nhiều công việc phía sau, như những buổi giao lưu văn hóa, kỷ niệm mối quan hệ ngoại giao giữa hai nước, v.v. Ít ai biết rằng những buổi giao lưu, kỷ niệm trên lại là những hành động ngoại giao rất hữu hiệu trong việc tăng cường mối quan hệ hợp tác song phương giữa hai nước. From a historian point of view, Dr. Andrew explicitly illustrated the workload of diplomacy with the two cases of French decolonization in Algeria and Brexit.
As a historian, one of the things I study is the French Empire, and in particular decolonization, which is how empires break apart and nation states are formed out of the former empires. And oftentimes these are diplomatic events, and one of the things that I studied is decolonization in French Algeria. And even though the Algerians fought a war of independence, much like the Vietnamese did against the French during the 1950s and 60s, an important part of that process wasn't just the fighting on the ground, but it was also the diplomatic campaign that Algerian nationalists undertook in order to build global support for their movement. This idea that Algeria should be independent because there was a lot of, there was an argument in France against independence. French policymakers really believed that Algeria was more than just a colony. It was a part of France, much the way that we may consider Hawaii to be a part of the United States. So as a result, Algerian nationalists had to convince the superpowers at the time, in particular the United States, the Soviet Union, along with a bunch of other powers that were allied with France, that maybe they shouldn't support France's war to keep Algeria French. And that wasn't easy. Algerian nationalists had to travel the globe, speaking with diplomats. Algerian nationalists actually even went to Hanoi and met with Ho Chi Minh in order to get inspiration for how they could fight the French, but also to get diplomatic legitimacy. It was important. At that time, Vietnam was already independent, and getting the support of an independent country like the Democratic Republic of Vietnam was really important. And even at the United Nations as well, this is really important. And a lot of historians believe that the success of the Algerian Revolution was in part a success of diplomacy. So in the case of Britain's pending exit from the European Union, what's interesting about that is, of course, it was a domestic issue that has international implications. So the diplomacy came in after the referendum was done in the summer of 2016. And of course, that has not been an easy process, because how do you essentially unravel the connections that were created by Britain's entry into the European Union almost 40 years ago? How do you sever those ties? That's not easy, and that's a diplomatic process. It's taking place on the regional level in terms of Britain and the European Union. It's even happening on the global level too. Britain's exit from the EU has implications for the United States, and has implications for other global actors as well. One of the things I find fascinating about Brexit, however, is you kind of have the high level diplomacy that's involved in, you know, treaties being signed, or in this case, abrogated, meaning kind of treaties being dissolved.
Even hearing from those who have yet to directly work in the field already gave us a sense of respect for diplomats. Now, let's look at what Madame Ninh and Matthew have contributed throughout their career. Madame Tom Nu Thi Ninh served Vietnam as a diplomat for more than two decades, specializing in global issues, international peace and security, development, environment, governance and human rights, and multilateral institutions, United Nations, Non-Aligned Movement, Francophony, ASEAN. In her capacity as a diplomat, an elected official, and currently an educational and social-cultural advocate and facilitator, Madame Ninh has consistently worked to build bridges of understanding and cooperation between Vietnam and the rest of the world. Apart from her continuing work on post-war aftermath, such as the need for rapprochement with Vietnamese diaspora, and the impact of war legacies such as Agent Orange, the Oxen in Vietnam, having been founding co-chair of the U.S.-Vietnam Dialogue Group on Agent Orange 2007 to 2008. She is actively involved in inclusive and sustainable development, gender advancement, youth empowerment, and nation branding, especially through the Ho Chi Minh City Peace and Development Foundation. Given her rich international experience and her lifelong commitment to Vietnam's all-round development and engagement with the world, Madame Ninh is frequently called upon to address international gatherings inside and outside Vietnam. Through her frequent interaction with the public, especially youth, women, and the media, she is known as one of the public figures with a meaningful voice in Vietnam, inter alia through her first book, Reflecting and Sharing, now in its 8th edition.
Most of my career I've spent in Asia. I've worked in Thailand, in South Korea, in Washington, D.C., in Laos, and then I spent 3 separate years in Iraq, spread out over my career, and I'm here in Vietnam now. Here, I'm the public affairs officer, so what that means, I cover the consulates, cultural programs, our educational outreach, our exchange programs and scholarship programs, our English language programs. I manage the American Center here in Diamond Plaza, and then also our press and social media outreach, working together to stop HIV/AIDS, you know, working together to promote free and fair and reciprocal trade between our countries, working together to promote regional security, right? Helping to build governance in Vietnam. Those are all things that Vietnam wants. Those are all things the U.S. wants. So it's really easy to do. The achievement that means the most to me is when I look back at my time in Laos. So I was in Laos from 2014 to 2017, and I was very involved with planning President Obama's trip to Laos.
Mm-hmm.
He was the first U.S. president to visit Laos ever, right? And so we were asked to, help him and the White House team understand Laos, understand what we wanted to do there, and to come up with things that could help move our relationship forward. So as part of that, the ambassador asked me to be the control officer. So that's a term that we use, when a VIP visits a place, the control officer is the one who sets up their schedule, figures out what they're going to do, works on the logistics, takes care of that person while they're traveling. So I was asked to be the control officer for Ben Rhodes, who was the deputy national security advisor to the president. He'd been a former speechwriter for President Obama, and he was one of the people that was really, really close to President Obama, and they worked together to come up with our foreign policy initiatives. And so I set up a program with Ben Rhodes where we wanted to show them the important work that we're doing, but also the challenges that we were facing, and frankly, the challenges that Laos was facing. So one of our biggest policy priorities in Laos is working on war legacy issues. That's helping, recover the remains of U.S. soldiers who died during the conflict there. And it's helping to clean up UXO and unexploded bombs, things that were still impacting the daily lives of Lao people. These are some of the activities we're still working on in Vietnam too, right? So I worked with the Lao UXO authority to bring Ben Rhodes to a UXO site in central Laos near Luang Prabang. And we arranged this amazing trip where he rode on a boat an hour up the river to this little village. We got out in the village, all the school kids were there, and it's a really, really poor village, right? All the school kids were there, a lot of them didn't have shoes on, but they really, they welcomed him, they sang this very cute Lao song, Savaiti. And then we went to a school. We went to their school, which was, a 5-minute drive or a 10-minute walk. It's really close, but the roads were terrible. And, while we showed him the school, we also showed him the UXO site, which was literally, it was in the school's, playground.
Outside of school?
Right outside the school. There was the school, there was a field right next to it, and there was unexploded ordnance there.
Oh.
And so this was something that those kids had to deal with for their lives. And then we went and we gave him the opportunity to blow up some of those UXOs, right? Push the button, bomb blows off, right? And it's oh, cool, right? Who doesn't like blowing things up? It's kind of awesome. But then we went back to the beach where the kids were, and our colleagues who were waiting there said, those kids didn't even look up when the bomb went off. And so on the boat ride back to Luang Prabang, you could see Ben start to think about, this is their lives, right? And that these 10-year-old Lao kids were still dealing with the remnants of a war that stopped 40 years ago. And it was still impacting their daily lives. And frankly, it was leading to some of them being injured and killed. And so we went back to Luang Prabang, and he went back to Washington, D.C. 2 days later. And he sent the ambassador an email, and he CC'd me on this email, where he said that he had talked to President Obama, and they decided they were going to do something about UXO. And the result of that is we promised an additional $70 million to allow us to help take, I think it was $70 million, it was a big chunk of money, to help remove this UXO. And so, you know, to me that's a big accomplishment, right? Because, you know, my work and that trip and all the work I put into it led to U.S. assistance to help Lao children live happier, healthier, safer lives, right? Hopefully that would help them have a better opinion about the United States, but I don't care. Like, as a human being, ultimately, right? My work helped them help keep Lao kids safe. And so I felt like a really big sense of personal accomplishment with that, right? We are doing a lot of things on war legacy issues, you know, remediating dioxin from, like, the Da Nang Airport, from Binhua, helping make, you know, community safer for people to use and site safer. We are doing a lot of UXO work up in along the former DMZ, along the former border between South Vietnam and North Vietnam, sort of removing the legacy of war. So we're doing that concrete stuff that's sort of, like, backwards looking. And then we're also doing work that's forward looking. So we're helping support the establishment of Fulbright University Vietnam, right? And we're working on, you know, getting more Vietnamese kids to study in the U.S., right? Work on scholarship programs, exchange programs, promoting English language education. And that's less about working with, like, about the past and more about, you know, impact, right, the next generation, helping empower you guys to play a bigger role in Vietnam's development. Like, that's a great thing. Because ultimately, like, I feel that a sort of safe, stable, secure, sovereign, wealthy Vietnam, it's good for you. It's also good for the relationship with the United States, right? That's what we want too.
Being able to help such influencers on both political and social issues is a great accomplishment. In order to achieve those once-in-a-lifetime goal, what characteristics and skills a diplomat need to acquire, and how do they practice it?
Là sự gắn kết và kỳ lợi ích tối cao của đất nước. Xác định lợi ích tối cao không phải là đơn giản. Cái tự chủ nó là cái yêu cầu của đối ngoại nói chung. Đó, thì và phải có bản lĩnh. Nguyên tắc là gì? Là cái này tôi cũng nói nhiều nơi rồi, nhưng mà tôi nhắc lại nhanh thôi là tự trọng của dân tộc. Tại vì nếu mình làm cái gì để cho người ta nghĩ người Việt Nam dễ dãi lắm rồi, không khó rồi, xin cái gì cũng được, đòi cái gì cũng được. Nếu người ta mà nghĩ như thế thì coi như mình thất bại. Cá nhân tôi thì tôi nghĩ tôi cũng dám chắc, nhưng mà tôi nghĩ rằng tôi chưa bao giờ để cho bất cứ đối phương hay là đối tác nào nghĩ như thế về tôi, nhưng mà đồng thời xung quanh tôi là về Việt Nam. Trong chừng mực tôi có đại diện được cho Việt Nam thì tôi chưa bao giờ để cho người ta có thể nghĩ như vậy. Cho nên là phải chuyên nghiệp, phải luôn quan sát, học hỏi và rút kinh nghiệm. Mình là ngoại giao, mình bước vào một cái phòng tiệc là mình phải cảm nhận ngay là trong phòng này có cái gì, có vấn đề gì không. Đó, nên mình và mình tự định vị liền. Và cái này là đặc biệt áp dụng cho nữ, đó là kết hợp tầm nhìn và sự uyển chuyển kinh tế. Nếu mà mình chỉ chăm chăm là mình nhẹ nhàng uyển chuyển thì đúng là mình gây cảm tình được. Nhưng mà lúc nào đó họ sẽ không nể mình theo mình, họ không thấy mình có cái tầm nhìn. Cho nên mình phải trao dồi sao để mình có tầm nhìn.
I guess a skill set or a personality thing that I got from my experience studying abroad is the importance of seeing things from other people's perspective. So, you know, when I'm like talking to somebody about doing something, I try to put myself in their shoes, right? I try to see the world as they see the world, because that helps me understand. I know what my red line is. It helps me understand what their red line is. And then we can figure out where in the middle we're going to go. Optimistic. Right? So I'm optimistic or positive. You can choose which one. They're slightly different, but more or less the same. I am open-minded. And I'm not afraid. I'm not afraid to try new things. I'm not afraid to, like, to do something and have it fail. Because if it does, then fine. Then I know it doesn't work and we can try something else.
I learned that you have to be confident, you have to be decisive and responsible for what you've thought and what you've done. And because it relates to not only you, but for the whole country that you represented for.
If those mentioned above have yet to give you a clear-cut picture on diplomatic skills, we'll also bring you Madam Ninh's appealing story about diplomats' approach on the field.
Không thể nói thỏa hiệp mà không đề cập đến lợi ích. Tại vì cái mà mình mỗi bên tìm kiếm là gì? Là lợi ích tối đa có thể được. Có thể này nó được quy định bởi gì? Bởi khách quan là chủ quan. Khách quan là tương quan lực lượng, tập hợp lực lượng. Cho nên khách quan mà nói là mình phải đánh giá được mình đang tiếp cận ai, mình đang đàm phán với ai và trong bối cảnh nào, thời điểm nào, lợi thế của mỗi bên, thế yếu của mỗi bên là gì. Mình phải biết mình muốn gì, mình cố gắng đạt cái gì, nhưng mà mình cũng phải đoán được cái nghiên cứu tìm hiểu tối đa có thể là đối phương muốn gì và sẵn sàng trả giá như thế nào hay là không trả giá. Ra trận là không thể là không có cái củ cà rốt dù bé nhỏ đến đâu. Cho nên là ngay cả cái phương án cao nhất cũng trên thực tế có cái củ cà rốt bé xíu. Nhưng mà bảo tôi ra trận, tôi đạt được hết, tôi không tốn một xu thì phải nói cái đó là tôi rất muốn nghe trường hợp nào mà trường hợp duy nhất đó có lẽ là cái nước thắng trận tuyệt đối như Mỹ đối với Đức và Đức Nazi, Đức Fascist và Nhật Fascist. Tại vì họ ở tư thế là không mà mở miệng được. Chứ còn trong cái thời bình thường, đàm phán thương mại, đàm phán ở công ước quốc tế, việc gì ở công ước khu vực không thể nào có cái chuyện đó. Chỉ có winner take all là không có, mà phải có give and take. Give and take thì có thể liều lượng give and take nó sẽ khác nhau. Thế thì nhà ngoại giao ra trận là phải đương nhiên cố gắng là hy sinh củ cà rốt nhỏ nhất có thể. Đó. Thì cái đó cả là một cái khóa, là một nghệ thuật và một cái quá trình trải nghiệm nó mới giúp cho mình. Và đàm phán mà song phương và đàm phán đa phương nó khác. Thì đàm phán song phương thì có phần nó dễ hơn, tại vì mình chỉ có một đối tượng. Còn đa phương mình làm dấu thiên hạ thành thử nó có phần khó hơn. Nhưng mà đương nhiên thì những người làm ngoại giao thì biết là kết luận là đàm phán song phương có thể không phải lúc nào cũng dễ hơn. Nhiều đàm phán một cái hiệp định thương mại mà rất là quan trọng đó, với một cường quốc thì cường quốc thương mại và cả cường quốc về các mặt đó, thì cực kỳ khó luôn. Nhưng mà cái khó đó là cái khó của một cái tương quan được lớn là được nhỏ hơn. Còn cái khó của đa phương là làm giao thành họ, có nghĩa là khối Ả Rập thì đòi thế này, mà cái khối châu EU thì thế kia, rồi ASEAN thì quan điểm thế nọ, nên dung hòa rất nhiều quan điểm và lợi ích khác nhau. Thành thử là đó là cái đặc thù của đa phương.
On the other hand, behind all the spotlights of events and meetings, there are endless challenges, demands, deadlocks, and dilemmas throughout one's diplomatic career. It has never been easy for them to silently and boldly take on the noble work. But we believe in Vietnam and all over the world, there are always those who deeply care, cherish, and are wholeheartedly wishing to pursue diplomacy in international relations in general. We as the Diplomats Club member then set out to ask people what makes them so passionate about diplomacy.
Just as a burning love of a man for his country behind his determination, or a unshakable belief of a woman behind her sound and soft words, what makes diplomacy appealing to me is what stays behind what is shown.
I think diplomacy is really important to each person because it is one way to express yourself as well as your value.
For me, the values of diplomacy is the power of using soft power and negotiation to bring culture across border.
Càng học tôi càng gắn bó với quan hệ quốc tế và tôi thực sự xem ngành học này là một môn nghệ thuật. Aristotle khi xưa từng ví ngoại giao như một môn nghệ thuật tối cao, đòi hỏi người ta phải bỏ rất nhiều công sức để luyện tập, nhưng dường như chỉ có một bộ phận nhỏ những ai quan tâm hay theo học mới biết và hiểu về ngoại giao. Đó thực sự không phải là điều tôi mong muốn. Tôi cho rằng sẽ rất tốt nếu như mỗi người chúng ta đều có một chút tác phong ngoại giao cho bản thân mình, nên tôi trăn trở rất nhiều về việc làm sao để không phí phạm những điều hay tôi học được và có thể truyền tải được cho đại chúng.
Tristan stated his opinion.
Though it's regarded as a manifestation of soft power, we cannot deny that the inherent power of our voice, guided by the principles of diplomacy, created an avenue where our nation can peacefully settle disputes and engage each other in a manner highlight unity and cooperation.
Sorong, who also has an interest in diplomacy, shares about his choices and reasons.
Inter and intra-relation of states and the decision-making process, which is done by the institutions, both are my view of interest. I aim to involve mostly in any diplomacy views, especially the problem or conflict-solving, which can prevent the issue and argument by negotiating with one another. More precisely, diplomacy is one of the important tools which interactions shape in international stage. It can also prevent the conflict through the effective collaborative process.
He aimed to gain more experience in diplomacy by taking participation in ACR Youth Model at United Nations, USDMAM. But whether we need to become an official diplomat to practice the art of diplomacy is still debatable. Besides diplomats who work directly for the government, the term citizen diplomat offers a new way to view diplomacy. Accordingly, everyone can be a citizen diplomat.
I think it's important to remember that we can all be ambassadors and diplomats in our own way. Whether or not you are a credentialed diplomat employed by a Ministry of Foreign Affairs or not. I think the students at Fulbright are diplomats. I think the faculty who work here are diplomats. We're interfacing with Vietnamese society all the time, and we're representing not just the special partnership that Fulbright represents between the United States and Vietnam, but the partnership of Fulbright with the region and with the world, ultimately, right? We have foreign faculty from all over the globe who work here and who come and visit us. Eventually, we'll be getting students from ASEAN countries, and we hope to be a model regionally and globally. And so I would like to think that we all have the opportunity to be diplomats, and we shouldn't be afraid to do so.
Everyone is a diplomat. You are all diplomats, and you all represent your country, you represent your community, you represent everything. Just all of us are.
To me, with a certain amount of endeavor and willingness, everyone can be a citizen diplomat, because we all have some values to stand for. The only thing that we need to become a citizen diplomat is to understand what our values are and what we are serving for.
We asked Dan, why would you want to be citizen diplomats?
I also personally want myself to become a citizen diplomat because I want to go traveling all around the world and to learn about their cultures and make friends.
I really want to be a citizen diplomat because I am proud of the place I was born and I am living in. I'm proud of its values and its culture. I really want to preserve them and promote them.
I want to be like a bridge to connect people with people. Maybe you are not be a real diplomat to talk with other ambassador to bring peace to the world, but maybe you can be a mediator to the fight of your two friends and you can bring peace for them. And I believe that a small change can make a big change. Maybe you can bring peace for your two friends, five friends, and 10 friends, and other citizen diplomats out there do the same thing, and you are contributing to bring peace for the world.
I believe I have the soft skills that are eligible and sufficient to be a seasoned diplomat. So firstly, I have like the love for my countries. So like since my childhood, I have been doing many activities to contribute to the society in Ho Chi Minh City and Vietnam.
If the ordinary people like you and me have the responsibility to represent our hometown, our city, and to represent Vietnam, by becoming a citizen diplomat, I have the power to change how my city and how my culture, how my country is viewed by my own backyard and around the world. I also have the chance to create a community that have integrity and humanity. As a Fulbright student, I would like to comment on citizen diplomacy from the view of education. For me personally, these two fields share one desirable characteristic, that is autonomy, the art of shared governance. Autonomy in diplomacy is shown by the fact that no single individual can well represent their country. Instead, a group of people from all walks of life has to come together to demonstrate their true colors, has to raise their voice together in order to draw a natural and comprehensive picture of that nation. Not many think that feminine and youth can go with professional, but I disagree and I think otherwise. Risk-taking, innovative, the delicacy, but at the same time strong-minded. Those are all the desirable characteristics of diplomacy. So that for that, I think the beauty of Vietnamese young woman perfectly ally with the values of diplomats nowadays.
In this globalized and intensively exposed world, being a citizen diplomat should not only be considered as a choice, but rather a responsibility of each individual.
So as a citizen diplomat, what values are you standing for?
I stand for Vietnam.
My beloved country, Vietnam.
Love.
I stand for Fulbright and Vietnam. I stand for myself, Fulbright and Vietnam.
That the world we live in, that it should be a world in which men and women are equal. People of different races and ethnicities and nationality are equal. People of different sexualities are equal. And that we should judge people based on their character and their actions rather than on some intrinsic sort of quality that they have.
And I'm an ambassador for liberal arts education.
How do you endeavor to demonstrate that role in daily life and professional occasions?
I think that to demonstrate how a good citizen diplomat could start from very small action and behavior. For example, I remember back then in summer 2017, I got the opportunity to go to a student leadership conference in Italy with 500 other students. And that was an opportunity given to me by Operation Smile. And during the time there, we made a lot of friends, and the Vietnam group also performed very successfully the Chom Cơm song, a traditional song from Vietnam. And I think that by performing the song and to demonstrate our intellectual knowledge and make friends with others, we have successfully let others know that Vietnamese youth are very willing to make friends and to cooperate with others to make this world a better place.
I'm learning about the cultural values and its beauty. I sit down and listen to traditional music and watch the folklore paintings.
So, to do so, beside my knowledge and my behaviors, I need like some skill of a diplomat, like networking skill or communication skill, to have a proper contact with people outside. Last but not least, one of my biggest goals of my life is learn as many languages as possible to travel around the world and recognize myself as a seasoned diplomat to help me have the motivation to learn language and to achieve one of my biggest goals.
So I've been joining social projects and in Saigon helping children and other disadvantaged groups, and also like lately I have been traveling around Vietnam to see like what are the issues around our country, such as like in Sapa there are human trafficking, or child labor and all that. So like, I believe like my spirit and my passion is the key element to be a seasoned diplomat.
I am working on how to maintain and build more international relationships so that I can learn more about the diplomacy world and improve my communication skills.
Có thể nói rằng tôi trau dồi khả năng cho bản thân bằng cách đi góp nhặt từng đồng kiến thức. Tôi hay nói chuyện với các thầy cô, tham gia những buổi giao lưu với các diễn giả. Các nhà ngoại giao đã trải qua những giai đoạn biến động của Việt Nam. Tuy là các bác đã về hưu, nhưng các bác vẫn rất tâm huyết và sẵn sàng chia sẻ những trải nghiệm, bài học với thế hệ trẻ tụi tôi. Bên cạnh đó thì tôi cũng phải tự học rất nhiều tại học viện.
When there is a will, there is a way. We continued asking our beloved diplomats for their advices on how to professionally thrive on the art of diplomacy.
Mình trở thành nhà ngoại giao giỏi là vừa bằng cách mình đọc sách, mình nghiên cứu, mình tham khảo. Nhưng mà mình học trong thực tiễn và thực hành có thể là nhiều hơn.
But it's to try, and don't be afraid to try, right? Don't be afraid to try and fail, and if you fail, then so what? Get up and try again. If you don't try, you're never going to succeed, right? So just try, and keep trying forever.
But the attempt of formal and citizen diplomats only is merely enough. Sustainable growth and prosperity for all require shared effort from all walks of life, as Madam Ninh has shared.
Dù có những cá nhân nỗ lực, có chuyên môn, có kinh nghiệm, giỏi giang mà nỗ lực đi nữa, thì không đủ để làm nên một cái mặt trận đối ngoại. Phải có những cái tập thể đó, cho nên là đây là một cái nỗ lực chung của cả một đội ngũ ấy. Cả thành phần làm nên tranh kẹp đó là vô cùng ngày càng đa dạng, từ cả nhà ngoại giao cho đến là các doanh nhân và các doanh nghiệp, nhà khoa học, nhà nghệ sĩ nổi tiếng, những vận động viên nữa. Thì trong cái bức cạnh tranh này thì không thể thiếu cái đóng góp và cái bộ mặt của cộng đồng người Việt ở hải ngoại, ở nước ngoài.
Hence, diplomacy should never be bound within a meeting room. It happens everywhere, anytime. From the words of diplomats all spread one nation, all the way across the globe and beyond. And we are confident that is what diplomacy should be like. Whenever we go, we shall embrace diversity and unity. We shall be limitless and community-minded, bringing the spirit of diplomacy from domestic to international scale. Finally, coming to the end of this cinematic journey, we invited the participants to send some wishes to the past, current, and prospective diplomats. Let our minds go around the world, and let our hearts space.
Just be confident, believe in yourself, and learn the skill so you can be a seasoned diplomat.
I know that being the diplomats for a country means that you have to put the national interest in front of others. But I hope that you put your nationality, your political ideology aside, and work together towards a common goal to protect and promote the welfare of this world.
We have to build the hours before we work for the eye, and we need to engage. We need individual citizens to care about Vietnam moving forward. I hope you can use your power to make the world a better place. And always remember, be proud of who you are and be proud of where you're from. Thank you.
It's them who are carrying the Vietnamese legacy. I would like to send my best wishes to the woman in diplomacy. I wish that you can go on your journey of empowering many more women.
To our past, current, and prospective diplomats, I wish you health, joy, and a lifelong passion to pursue your meaningful career of being a diplomat.
And here is the wish from Sarong.
My final message to the world of diplomats is that everyone is encouraged to speak out your ideas from your heart and also express your perspectives to others without any fears or shyness, because the action will likely to bring you to the most precarious outcome in meantime. In addition, there's one phrase that I want to tell everyone: practice makes perfect.
My personal hope for the field is that young people like those of you in the Diplomats Club continue to get interested by diplomacy. I think we need a lot of young energy in international relations. But something that I've seen that troubles me is actually the lack of diplomacy that often happens. We live in an age where diplomacy is not necessarily something that's happening between cohorts of professional diplomats, but rather that diplomacy is becoming intensely personal. But oftentimes a lot of diplomacy doesn't happen with a tweet. It doesn't happen with a face-to-face meeting between two world leaders. It's the kind of long, arduous, arguably boring, interface between professional diplomats. And that may not on the face of it seem particularly intriguing or sexy, but I think it's important to remember that it's exactly that which we need more of right now. And I think a great way to do that is just to have young people, particularly who are interested in becoming diplomats or are interested in international relations, to travel, engage in study abroad, make friends from far and wide, learn cultures, learn languages.
Cho nên tôi xin chúc những người trong câu lạc bộ ngoại giao của Đại học Fulbright cũng như là những thanh niên và sinh viên, những nhà nghiên cứu trẻ khác là sẽ tiếp tục quan tâm, đóng góp, triển khai những gì mình cảm thấy là hợp với mình và mình cảm thấy là mình có thể có những cái đóng góp có ý nghĩa hơn nữa. Thì cái lĩnh vực này tôi nghĩ nó ngày nay nó rộng mở hơn lúc trước nhiều, cho nên các bạn hãy mạnh dạn và giữ vững cái quan tâm này, đất nước và xã hội Việt Nam rất cần những nhà ngoại giao chuyên nghiệp cũng như là những nhà đối ngoại không chuyên nghiệp tâm đắc với cái gọi là tâm hồn và hình ảnh của đất nước.
And to close the curtain, we would like to end on a lovely note from Tristan to our documentary.
I send my warmest regards to the world of diplomats. May this endeavor of yours be successful and may it yield wonderful results. Continue to create avenues where your voice can be heard and forge lasting bonds across borders and community.
This is to say, the film is far from perfection. As our club is young and fresh, we're still fueled with subjective opinions, and a more diverse pool of interviewees would help them as good. However, we were beyond honored and moved to receive stories and sharing about your profession, your talks, emotions and experience.
Many more diplomatic projects are coming, and we are blessed to have you as our companion. We wish to continue this tradition in order to connect, collab, and together embrace the world of diplomats, those who are connecting the world in the name of love and peace.